You're listening to the Deep Purple Podcast, a fan podcast about one of the most legendary bands of all time, Deep Purple. We take a look at the music, history, and people behind the band Deep Purple and beyond.
Welcome to the Deep Purple Podcast, the first and only podcast devoted to one of the greatest bands in rock history, Deep Purple. Today's episode is episode number 175, The Battle Rages On, Part 1. And coming to you from the back-to-school suburbs of Chicago, I'm your host, Nathan Beaudry.
And coming to you from the suburbs of Providence, Rhode Island, I'm your co-host, John Mini Eggs Mottola.
Mini eggs, like not Cadbury mini eggs. It's way too late or early for that.
Or is it?
Oh, did you find out? You found a stash. Oh man.
No. Basically, looks like summer's coming to a close. You said that it's the back to school suburbs, so your kids must be back.
Yeah, they started school yesterday.
It's wow.
Crazy. Already wow. Back at school, back at it. But yep, here we are, ready to dive into an important subject. But before we move on, got a few things here. There's a number of ways you can support our show. One is by leaving us a 5-star review on Apple Podcasts. Two, you could always buy some merch at our Etsy store. You become a patron on Patreon or via PayPal for as little as $1 a month. Help support the show. You can also donate $DPPOD using Cash App. So speaking of patrons,
Hey-o!
We've got a new patron joining us at the $25 Uncommon Man tier.
Wow.
We have Purple Maniac, lifelong Purple fan. So yeah,
he's been very vocal in the Discord lately.
Yeah, we've been talking in the Discord, already in the Discord channel, and had kind of popped into the Patreon before and popped out and popped back in because they were looking to up their he was looking to up his donation, which he did, coming in at the highest tier, at the Uncommon Man tier. So really, really appreciate that. Some great discussion in the Discord, and yeah, it's been a lot of fun. So welcome. So speaking of our patrons, at the executive level, we have the $25 Uncommon Man tier, which is Ovis Nokvi and Purple Maniac. At the $20 What's Going On Here tier, we have Richard Fusey. At the £10 tier, Dr. Jill Brees. At the Turn It Up to $11 tier, Clay Wambacher, Frank Thielgard Mortensen, Alan Ain't Too Proud to Beg, and Mikkel Steen. And at the $10 Someone Came tier, Ryan M., Jeff Bryce, Victor Campos, Better Call Saul Evans, and Kev Roberts and his wonderful children, Matthew, Gareth, and Sarah. We'll thank our other patrons throughout the show. So thank you for bearing with us as we catch up from our long summer, our unexpected summer break here.
Yeah, we couldn't seem to make it work. I mean, between that, like you coming back here, then I went away, then yep. You went away, I came back. My family just left today. Spent, a lot of time, it was just Pops's birthday yesterday. We had a lot of, two days ago. So he's just turned 76. Grouchy as ever. but a bunch of people came, we've had like people over the house and like, activities with the girls, and stuff like that. So it's like, I feel like I get to spend a lot of time, now that they're older, it's more, we can do more activities with them. They even like text me and call me on the phone sometimes, which is great. I love it. Unfortunately from the summer, we do have some bad news.
What's that?
Which we haven't talked about yet. We unfortunately will not be seeing each other. I will not be traveling to Chicago. I had to cancel my trip. Whitesnake, well, as everybody knows by now, canceled the rest of their tour.
Sadly, that might be it for Whitesnake.
It's bummed out. So you know what, the first thing I thought was Jorg's prediction was true. Whitesnake did not play on August 19th. That would have been tomorrow at this point. So
yeah, that's right. Yeah, and well, then, it wasn't a prediction so much as a statement. He was like, well, if Whitesnake does play on the 19th, it'll be the first time you've ever played a show. And
but I feel like even though it was secondhand info, you said that he said it, I feel like he said it like, yeah, we'll see, like it's not going to happen. So it was a premonition. So, yep. You know, my original intention was to keep the date and go out there, and we would still hang out, record some shows, you know, some live, live streams together. But long story short, things just fell apart at work, and I'm like, I can't leave.
We'll save it for someday in the future.
Exactly. It's not like if there was still a show going on, I would just like turn to my boss and say, yeah, let things fall apart. I'm not missing white steak. Since it was just us hanging out, like we could feel like now that we've kind of like, you know, broken the seal, so to speak, you know, about a year ago doing this. And then you came back. I feel like we can just kind of get together whenever. So,
I'll figure it out.
You know, yeah, exactly. And I mean, you know, I got the airline credit, you know, we can catch Deep Purple on their next run round, you know.
That's right.
So,
well, in other news.
Hey,
we have an Apple Podcast review.
Woo!
This one comes to us from Mooties, I believe is the name.
No, it's not.
No, this one comes to us from the UK. I love Mags, 5 stars, title Great Fun Podcast on Deep Purple. It says, I wrote this review several months ago. Okay, sometime last year, but I forgot to send it. So here it is. I found out about this excellent podcast by accident, and I absolutely love it. It's a great fun listen, and I absolutely love the natural humor. I've only played a few episodes, so have loads to catch up. The House of Blue Light review was very interesting. I saw Purple on tour at Wembley, London, UK. On that evening, Blackmore refused to do an encore.
big shocker.
So Lord and Glover played lead. It was definitely an interesting version of Smoke on the Water. Having seen Gillan in mind-blowing vocals form the band live in 81, it was noticeable Ian lost some of his range power by 87, 88. Overall, he is still great. Keep up the great work. Thank you. P.S. The latest Accidentally on Purpose episode was excellent. I'd forgotten how good this album was. Like you, I appreciate it more now. I bought it when it came out and wasn't sure that I liked it back then. All right. Thank you. I love Mags. We love you. Really appreciate it. Always nice to get some reviews. And if you want to hear the Flexitone go sound off, make sure to leave us a review. A review on Apple Podcasts. So before we get into the main meat of the subject, and you know, sorry, we had a big wind up this week, but before we get into that, we do have one more thing to cover. That's right, folks. It's Postcards from the Edge of Connecticut. Now, this one is not actually a postcard, but it's an actual letter. Although, funny, before I left Rhode Island, my parents received a postcard from Peter Gardo, so they're now on his postcard list.
Of course.
This one is a, you know, when I see a folded up thing in there, I know he's cut out something from the paper for me, and that's it's a picture of the Golden Girls.
Oh.
It says, and he's written us a little note on the top there, and it says, Nate, with the White Snake. With the White Snake being canceled, perhaps you and John can find time to hit the GG pop-up, whatever that is. And now it's talking about this pop-up, this Golden Girls restaurant pop-up. It's designed to like themed after the restaurant. So at first I got really excited. I was like, oh my God, is it in Chicago? Because we could go, because we didn't know you were going to be canceling yet. But it's actually, what says, John Saunders of Cranston, Rhode Island. Teenage children, their mother visiting Northern California when they learned about the pop-up. So it's in Northern California. So we'll have to just plan a trip out there to see this pop-up. I know they're doing these pop-ups for like Stranger Things and stuff like that. So why not do the Golden Girls? So
they better have some damn good cheesecake on the menu.
That's right. So thank you very much, Mr. Peter Gardo, for the lovely little letter you sent. All right, John, it is that day, the day we've finally gotten here. We've gotten to the battle rages on.
Oh boy.
So this is it. This is it. This is the end of the Blackmore era in Deep Purple.
Yeah.
The last Blackmore, Although if you listen to social media, there's a lot of people. Actually, have we even talked about it on the show that Steve Morse is officially out of the band? I don't even know if we've talked about it on the show.
I don't know.
But at some point, it might have been after we recorded last, but he made his official departure from the band,
which I'm sure everybody knows by now.
It's old news by now. And then by the time this episode comes out, it'll be even older news. But yeah, he's officially left the band for, you know, very, very, very good reasons and on very good terms, obviously. Well, I mean, very not good. I shouldn't say good reasons, but it's for bad reasons. But, you know, obviously he's still friends with everybody. And
right. He left on good terms. But, the reason he left was not, you know, for, you know, honorable reasons, you know.
Yeah. And he's, you know,
take care of his wife.
Much, much, much needed time with the family in a time of need. So obviously, yeah, miss him terribly, but we got tons of Steve Morse stuff to cover on the show in the years to come. So
yeah, haven't even touched it yet. So
exactly. I mean, just basically scratched the surface. But yeah, there's a lot of people like, maybe Blackmore will go back in the band. Sure.
That didn't even that's where we are at this point is that didn't even cross my mind. Like, I'm just
not
like
even for a second. I think anybody that's paying attention, that's not going to cross their mind. Like you clearly, they just know that he left in 93. They haven't listened to anything since. And they're just like, oh, Blackmore will go back. Oh yeah, that'll work.
Sure. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. He's going to hang up his friggin' lute and you know, come back to Deep Purple. Here, let me take off this felt, pixie cap and I'll be right there. Those boots, whatever those things are.
One of the best, yeah. It's ridiculous.
Look at his orthopedic, his orthopedic medieval boots.
Orthopedic.
Man, those things look uncomfortable. Oof.
Oh yeah, they look like they've got no. I'm sure the boots they're based on have very little arch support.
Breathability,
yeah. You're just sweating, and it's like a swamp in there, a swamp of plantar fasciitis.
Yeah, I'm sure Richie's gonna hang up his Robin Hood hat and run back to Deep Purple.
Three-cornered hat. He's gonna return. Well, it's funny though, when the last time he left Deep Purple, or you know, he immediately reformed Rainbow and he brought the Pilgrim hat back. Well, sort of like a variation on the Pilgrim hat.
Yeah.
It'd be great if he just came back to Deep Purple and just put the hat back on. And but anyway, it's not happening, folks. Everybody knows that. But you know, it's just funny to talk about it. But anyway, here we are. The battle rages on. Before we kind of get into the lead up to this album, you know, this is a two-parter, so we're going to talk about the lead up to the album. We're going to review half the tracks on the album. Next week we'll join you back with covering the other half of the album and what happened after the album, well, some of what happened after the album, because it's a big story after that, and talk about some reviews of the album and stuff like that. So when we do these Deep Purple proper albums in the CD era, we've really been breaking them up into two episodes because there's just too much to cover, and we want to, you know, even if we cut out our banter about Airbnbs and Golden Girls, it would still be like a 3+ hour episode. And
yeah, and we're already a half hour in and haven't really talked about Deep Purple yet.
a little bit.
Whoops.
So anyway, here we are, lead up to the album. What are your thoughts and memories of this album, if any?
So when was it, 93?
Yep.
Yeah. So, I mean, 93 was definitely already a Purple fan. So this was the new Purple album at the time for me. I mean, by the time that I had gotten Slaves and Masters, that was the last new one that came out. So this was being released as I was actively a Purple fan. So I was excited that Mark II was back, that I got to actually hear a Mark II album in real time. That being said, I remember when I, and you might remember things I don't, because at this point, I think we were definitely friends by then.
Sure.
I remember not really being too impressed with the album cover or the music within. Like, I was just kind of almost disappointed, you know, and now I know it's from a, you know, disclaimer is I have rarely listened to anything on this album in the past 30 years, however long it's been, so my memory is shoddy. So I mean, I do know that I listened to it a lot, but also when I got albums regardless of whether I liked them or didn't like them, if that was the new thing, or, you know, I only had limited things to listen to, I would listen to it whether I liked it or not. So I remember listening to it and, you know, in hindsight, knowing that, like, you know, I did not really like the production. Wasn't really crazy about the songs. It wasn't like, I don't know, reunion album that many years later. It's just kind of like, I don't know, maybe I was expecting like Son of Machine Head or something like that, but you know, at the time wasn't really my favorite. And then, you know, that was evidenced by the fact that, or cemented by the fact rather, that, you know, I haven't really listened to it since. I actually can't really name any tracks on there, except maybe, I think there was a song called Lick It Up. And I'm just like, that was a Kiss song. So I was like, instantly the title turned me off, because it was like, all right, derivative, you know, like whatever. Yeah, so not really one of my go-to albums, but, you know, thinking, I don't know, maybe hearing it on the show now, maybe I'll feel differently about some of the tracks.
Yeah, I think that I mean, I echo a lot of what you said, and I think it was because we were just starting to get into Deep Purple at the time. And I think I had, you know, recently gotten all of the back albums. So for me, you know, getting into Machine Head and Fireball and In Rock and everything, I wasn't really reaching for this one very often. But I think this is kind of pre me really discovering Mark 3 and 4. So I was like, I was just kind of cycling through the earlier Mark 2 stuff. Who Do We Think We Are was always, you know, Who Do We Think We Are in Fireball were usually my go-tos. Machine Head and In Rock were great as well. So I was always kind of going between those, and, you know, I'd get this and I'd be like, oh, okay. And then, you know, it's kind of hard when you're, you know, if we had been listening to those albums for 25 years, I think it might've been a little bit more sense to dive into this one a little bit, but those were still so new and fresh that I was rotating those a little bit more in my collection. But yeah, so as we get into the where we last left off, Mark 5 was still kicking. We did our Slaves and Masters episode, I don't know, 6 months ago or whatever. But there was a lot of problems, obviously, with Mark 5. First of all, there were changing tastes. And it's very interesting looking at this whole album through the prism of, you know, grunge was like in full swing at this point. And you see that a lot in the reviews, when we'll get into the reviews in the next episode, but grunge was going full swing. And it's just funny, even though I was there at the time and I heard these both at the time, I don't think of it as being the same time and that being the big thing. So, you know, the appetite for the style of music that Mark V was putting out was, I think, considered pretty old. In Europe, the Soviet Union had just fallen. In Eastern Europe, I think Deep Purple with Joe Lynn Turner saw like their biggest success, because they were so eager for any sort of rock shows to be coming to that area that they were, you know, they were just, you know, just thrilled to be getting into that sort of stuff. And they were a little bit behind from that standpoint, because they've been denied this stuff for such a long time. But, you know, it's still Deep Purple and they have that iconic image, and that kind of carried them through all of this. At BMG, they weren't too happy with the direction of the band. Joe Lynn Turner's presence seemed to give them a little bit more of a generic appeal that wasn't really considered super. I don't know. They weren't considered. It kind of like when, you know, John Lord will say it's not a Deep Purple album. It just didn't feel like Deep Purple. So in November of 1991, they began work on their new album at Greg Reich Studios in Florida. Joe Lynn Turner says, "We come up with some great tracks, and they'd all turn around and say it's awful. Singing with those guys was a dream come true and a nightmare waiting to happen." So, so Joe Lynn Turner showing some, you know, there'll be a lot of kind of sour grapes sort of things from Joe Lynn Turner throughout this. Colin Hart says the picture of the tour he paints a picture of the tour, like around Slaves and Masters. He describes like these one-off gigs in Eastern Europe and just saying it didn't have a great feeling to it. He said Bruce Payne, manager, always knew when it was time to really orchestrate some changes in the band. So he said that, you know, the money was starting to dry up, the gigs were starting to dry up a little bit. And when Colin was asked to book the band into Woodstock, New York, And they found an old studio built by Bob Dylan's manager, Albert Grossman. And they started work on the new album there. So they always like to go in somewhere in like upper New England or upstate New York to start working on an album. They recorded some material through January of 1992, but eventually they started to look at some outside songwriting help from Jim Petterick, the songwriter behind Survivor. Roger Glover said he wasn't happy with this move, and he saw his creative input in the band being kind of in jeopardy, so they kind of pulled back from that. Joe Lynn Turner had a more positive relationship with Petterick, and he describes some really cool stuff they wrote. So Joe Lynn Turner will be referencing all of these songs using different names because they were all rewritten by Gillan. But he says that songs titled Lost in the Machine, The Stroke of Midnight, and Little Miss Promiscuous.
A very JLT title.
Miss Mistreated. I wonder if she's related to Miss Mistreated. He says, we were just ripping it up with social statements and all that kind of stuff. We were sort of becoming an angst band, but with commercial attitude and a lot of great music. So I'm sure you would have loved to hear an angsty Joe Lynn Turner, a grunge Lynn Turner, Joe Lynn Grunger.
Grunge Lynn Turner. Yeah.
Grunge. So Roger talks about songs called Just Don't Call It Love, Put Your Money Where Your Mouth Is, and Vicious Circle of Friends, and says it was a great idea, never brought to fruition. I have a demo somewhere. So yeah, Roger's always got like the demos somewhere, but I don't know if we'll ever hear them. So then in 1992, the record label starts to hype up. Hey, this is the 25th anniversary of the band. Big deal, 25 years. There was a lot of excitement. But they really decided to use that as an excuse to try to lobby for a change in the band. Everyone in the band other than Blackmore felt like that Joe's style was not a good mix with the band.
Of course.
There'd been some early contacts with Gillan about reuniting again. Blackmore was the only one who did not agree. Gillan wasn't the only option, though. They had talked about some other options, including Mike DeMeo, the singer of the band Riot. And Mike DeMeo says, Ritchie Blackmore asked me to join Deep Purple. That's the stuff that I like to sing. You know, I was supposed to sing on The Battle Rages On. And I had to start working on that record. I had started working on that record with Roger Glover. I only worked with them for about 3 months before BMG pulled the plug. They decided they wanted Ian Gillan to do the 25th anniversary. I have those same songs on CD with me singing them. Hmm. So there's, at this point, like, what, three versions of these songs now, one with Joe Lynn Turner, one with Mike DeMeo, and one with Gillan. Roger Glover says that they worked with DeMeo in a studio in Connecticut. He said it was okay. It wasn't too great. He says, at least I wasn't convinced. Ritchie really liked him, however. I don't know what was said between them. I never heard about him again until now. I still have the tape somewhere, so there's no danger of it ever being released. John Lord is usually one kind of going with the flow and accepting all of these kind of lineup changes. He says that basically Blackmore got an ultimatum from the rest of the band that he needed to accept Gillan back on board. So it took a lot of convincing by the label, and it seemed to be largely in the form of a huge cash payout to Blackmore, basically just like, hey, take all this cash and let Gillan back in the band. The payout to Blackmore was allegedly around $2 million. Some said that, Ritchie, he was going through his third divorce at the time, and that he just really accepted the offer because he needed the money to for all the financial burden that was putting on him. So Blackmore says he was simply outvoted and said, I'll go along with that. But Blackmore says that they needed a scapegoat for the success of the band, and that Joe Lynn Turner was that scapegoat. So Glover was given the task of convincing Gillan to come back. They took a phone call. He considered it for a few days, and there was a little bit of hesitation because Gillan was kind of in the press all the time, and he famously said, I'd rather slit my throat than sing with that band again. Mm. Seems pretty final, but apparently he was able to convince him. Gillan had put together a four-piece band called Repo Depot, which we talked, I think, about a little bit about in our last episode. And he'd been kind of bebopping around doing some solo stuff and doing his Garth Rocket stuff that we covered in last week's episode. Phil Banfield, Gillan's manager, was frustrated with Gillan not immediately going back to Deep Purple, and he threatened to quit, which Gillan said finally got him to accept the offer. Gillan said he really loved Repo Depot and where they were going. He was sad to leave it behind, but decided to join back with Deep Purple. Colin Hart says Roger Glover flew to England with demos of the material to see if Gillan could still sing at his previous level. So Gillan describes in his book, like, kind of being really pissed off, like Glover was going over there to audition him. And he's like, are you fucking kidding me? I have to audition for Deep Purple. But I think the reality was they just didn't know in the years since he, you know, only been a few years, but can he still bring it? Yeah. But obviously he's Ian Gillan, so he did. Even if he was disgusted by that. So Gillan knew that he was coming back into the band against Blackmore's wishes. So obviously it was tense right from the very get-go. So they headed on to Red Rooster Studios in Germany, and then returned back to Bearsville Studios, then to Orlando at Greg Reich Studios. And Colin Hart describes showing Ritchie the biggest suite in the main guest house at the Red Rooster Studios for him to stay in. So, hey, Ritchie, this is where you're going to be staying. And he said Ritchie's first question was, I want to see where Ian and Roger are. So he wanted to make sure that his accommodations were better than better than theirs. Ritchie. And then what did he say? I think he said, so I don't think I wrote it down here, but in his book he was just like, oh, here we go with the shit again or whatever. You know, just here we go. So when Gillan got there, most of the backing tracks were already done. He just had to come in and write new lyrics and record new vocals of what was already there. So Blackmore, of course, preferred the original recordings done with Joe Lynn Turner. He said he accepted the ultimatum and he accepted the payout, but he still wasn't happy. And he said he basically gave really strict instructions to the producers and whoever, the management. I want Ian to sing it exactly like Joe Lynn Turner sang it, like this song. So clearly that's not going to happen and didn't happen. And Blackmore was pretty upset by that. So Gillan and Glover work together in the studio. They rewrite lyrics. They re-record everything. Other times in the studio, there've been a lot of people in there, but it was just kind of like a weird combination of just them. Mick Wall writes in Metal Hammer in August of 1993 that there was no real communication with Ritchie and Gillan when meeting back up again. There was no hello greeting. They just had a quick discussion about the songs. Then Blackmore played football and hung around a bit before going back to America. And then Gillan and Glover finished up the lyrics and the vocals in about 7 weeks. And then Gillan, finally, in Rock World, about recording the studio in Orlando, Florida, he says, I really enjoyed that. It was near a lake and I went out canoeing every morning. I went swimming and everyone was waving at me from the shore. I had no idea there was a dangerous alligator chasing me. So thankfully, this is not the last album by Ian Gillan after being consumed by a crocodile. So for a producer, they got this guy, Tom Panuzio. Ritchie said, I was at his club in Florida and I heard this track by Joan Jett. It had a very big sound and it was done by Panuzio. And it was so loud, I thought maybe we should use him. It's funny, I wrote Joan Jeff in there, so I had to translate that on the fly. It's Joan Jett, not Joan Jeff.
So what was the producer?
Tom Panuzio.
Hey, Tom Panuzio, a paisan. Hey.
Another paisan. So he'd worked with Joan Jett, obviously, Iggy Pop, Alice Cooper, the Reverend Horton Heat, and Patrick Swayze. So I wonder if he produced She's Like the Wind.
She's Like the Wind. Maybe.
I don't know, I'll have to look that up. So he produced it. Roger Glover also worked on production too. They had a bunch of folks. I'll have all the information in the show notes. Engineers Bill Kennedy, who actually worked with Megadeth. Hans Gemperl worked with a bunch of German acts. Jason Corsaro, who worked with The Cars, The Clash, and Gary U.S. Bonds.
Another connection.
Another U.S. Bonds connection. Unbelievable. Darren Schneider worked with Living Loud, Steve Morse Band, and the Hoochie Coochie Men. So a bunch of Deep Purple side projects there. Devin Emk, who worked with mostly jazz musicians. John Sickett, who worked with Sonic Youth. Fish and the Dave Matthews Band. A lot of jam bands there. I wonder if we're going to have any like 20-minute songs about David Bowie on this. Mark Canise, who played drums on Roger Glover's Mask album. Mike Reiter, who has a production credit on Fraley's Comet's Second Sighting album. So there you go. Pete Beckerman and Wally Walton. So those are all the engines. So as you get in these later albums, it's a ton of engineers, where back in the day it would be like one guy.
Yeah.
Things get a little more complicated. So that's the album there. You had talked a little bit about this already, but it's that time now where we have to kind of get into this. But what do you think about this album art? Give me a second to put it up here. All right. What do you think about it?
Hey, there we go. It's not bad. It always made me think that it would be a cool tattoo design.
Oh yeah. I've seen quite a few people have this one.
As a tattoo. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's like another like well illustrated album cover. I mean, you have some striking colors in there. I mean, red is always very, you know, bold, but there's something about it. I think it's just kind of like the beige, like almost like paper bag background, and like the deep purple logo looks really kind of cheap or kind of rushed. Mm-hmm. That it just kind of, I don't know, it didn't look like the concept didn't look like it was like really finished to me. Or I don't know, I didn't get it, you know, because it's like, I mean, I know that like Rainbow and, you know, those kind of bands like Deep Purple family albums have had these kind of like, you know, swords and sorcery and, you know, type of album covers. And, you know, so this would kind of be, you know, fall in with that, right? But it's like, I don't know, it just wasn't always my favorite. I can't really put my finger on it because it's not, like I said, it's not like bad artwork, but it almost looks like a tattoo artist designed it.
Yeah.
And they were just like, yeah, let's just slap it on the album cover. And like in the beige background and like the deep purple logo just always kind of rubbed me the wrong way, because it just, it looked kind of rushed or kind of amateurish, I guess you could say. Mm-hmm. Like everything except for the drawings of the dragons look kind of rushed.
That's a good point. I never really thought about that way, because I'm so like fixated on the dragons. I always really liked this album cover.
Yeah.
And maybe I was just because I was focusing on the albums. But now that you pointed out, yeah, it's got like that parchment, that old school parchment
right
backdrop. And then that brand new Deep Purple logo that was around for, you know, a little bit in the early 90s. And then you kind of never really saw
much
anymore, I don't think, after that. And we've talked before about how Deep Purple never really had a, they never really stuck with any logo. Probably the one they've used the most is the one from Stormbringer, which is unusual.
And then there's the album title, The Battle Rages On ... And then like the second period kind of goes into the wings. So it almost looks of the dragon. So it almost looks like they like messed up and put it too close and never changed like
it. They messed up with the kerning or the letting or whatever, whichever one that is. But it's funny you mentioned that, because I just noticed that now when you were talking about it for the first time, that yeah, they don't have all three dots for the ellipsis.
Yeah, like if they just like shrunk it down a little bit, it would have like, you know, that's what gives me the impression that it was rushed. Plus the fact that the Deep Purple logo that the dragons are like fighting within, like I said, it looks, you know, it looks like, you know, some kid doodled it on his like notebook or something. Like it's not a strong image like it was in the Perfect Strangers album, you know?
Right. Yeah. The logo itself, even though the dragons are done really well. That's funny. Where is that other dragon coming from? It looks like it's attached to the main dragon.
Yeah, like maybe they're one, they're interconnected. I don't know.
It would be very very emblematic of what was going on in the band at the time, which a lot of people made the comment on. All they deny that that's where that name came from. But this album cover was designed by Reiner Design Consultants, and the dragon graphic was done by James Grashow. He is a well-known New York wood sculptor and artist, and he actually did the album cover for Jethro Tull's Stand Up, that like illustrated cover. But this company had also designed the artwork for a number of people, including Madonna, Aerosmith, David Bowie, Metallica, and Queensryche. So they did the Metallica's $5.98 EP Garage Days. They did And Justice for All and Queensryche's Operation Mindcrime. So iconic album covers there. So yeah, that's the main cover. Then on the inside, you've got this very, I always kind of liked this when you opened it up. It was that fold out and has those like really colorful little bubbles. Almost looks like a pop-up video. little bubbles of, you know, information about where it was recorded, who's in the band, all that sort of stuff. And then on the inside, it was the black and white version with the, I think some of the versions were like Japanese. One of the versions was in full color, but this version that I have here that from the scan is, and of course my version's back there. I forgot to grab it out. But it's got just all the different lyrics for all the songs, which is pretty cool. And then the CD itself is just an image of that, the dragons and the deep purple logo. And the back cover is got these kind of little symbols, like a little like weird, I don't know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 9 or 10 armed bat or something, and some sort of weird star and weird crescent moon sort of thing. It's kind of odd. But yeah, I always liked the presentation of this album. That to me was one of the standout things about it, was really that that artwork.
I don't know. I always felt like when, you know, Deep Purple came back in the 80s, you know, their album art was really lacking. I mean, Perfect Strangers had something. It was pretty simple and to the point, but everything else, House of Blue Light, Nobody's Perfect, Slaves and Masters, it all seemed kind of, I don't know. It just didn't really hit the mark. You know, I mean, you're comparing against some really like kind of like classic album covers.
Yeah. I think Perfect Strangers was cool in just its simplicity.
Right. And establishing a new logo. But then after that, it was, and you know, not that like House of Blue Light was
establishing and then quickly abandoning a new logo.
Yeah, exactly. and House of Blue Light was interesting. And, you know, we talked about Slaves and Masters a little bit. I mean, they were like, okay, but it was just kind of looked almost like it was, you know, they're just like, all right, we got to cut something out of the budget. So let's cut something out of the art budget, you know?
Well, they blew their band lifetime album budget on the first album with that $250,000 picture of the five of them.
Hey, I'll still never get that one.
Well, yeah, I mean, it's interesting you bring up that like swords and sorcery thing, which we obviously know from Rainbow with Ritchie and JLT. But it's interesting that they put that in there, because you know you're not going to be getting that from Gillan lyrics. Gillan's right. Not a swords and sorcery kind of guy. So yeah, it's very, very interesting.
Which, I mean, it doesn't really look like, you know, that like that, like, you know, medieval or rainbow-ish. But I mean, you know, like the concept of like, you know, a couple of, you know, dragons kind of slithering around like that, you know, just seems to be along those lines. I don't know. The album art just never really grabbed me in the same way that some of the others did.
Yeah, makes sense. All right. So are we ready to get into some of these tracks here?
Yeah, let's hurry up.
All right. Let's what?
Let's hurry up. Come on. Let's get through this. No, I'm kidding.
But before we do that, there's of course something we have to do, and that is to thank our core level patrons. Coming in at the $7.77 Keep It Warm Rat tier, we have Michael Vader. At the episode $6.66 tier, we have Steve Coldwell, Arthur Smith, and Anton Glaving. At the $6.65 Almost Evil tier, we have Kenny Wymore. At the $5.99 Nice Price tier, we have Fielding Fowler, Robert Smith, Peter from Illinois, Michael Bagford and Carl Helberg. And at the $5 Moneylender tier, John Convery, German Heindel, Adrian Hernandez, Jesper Allman, Alexei the Perfect Stranger Slepikoff, James North, Mark Hodgetts, Will Porter, Zwapper the Electric Alchemist, Tim Southern Cross Johnson, and Percival Frequency. Thank you so much to all of your generous support of the Deep Purple Podcast. Okay, and with that, it is time to kick it off into the first opening track of the album, the titular, The Battle Rages On. rock and riff. I always like this riff a lot.
Yeah, definitely a departure from their previous sound, which was more classic light rock Deep Purple on the previous album.
So this song is written by Blackmore, Gillan, Lord, and Paice. Gillan said in an interview, this song is basically about Yugoslavia and the futility of trying to make love when all people want to do is kill each other.
Okay.
So the thought that the battle rages on is about the battle between Gillan and Blackmore. Really more about the battle. The battle of coming out of the Cold War and Soviet fall.
Oh, people are going to spin it however they want.
I mean, you can't blame them. The third time they're trying to make it work as a band, the battle, and we know the tumultuous relationship between the two. Why wouldn't you assume that? I doubt anyone seeing this album cover and hearing the title without knowing anything about it were like, it's probably about Yugoslavia.
It's about Yugoslavia and screwing. Oh, okay.
I could have probably guessed with the screwing.
Yeah, classic Ritchie. It's like a classic kind of a Deep Purple riff right there, kind of like a classical sounding.
Yep.
Yeah, this is definitely like on the heavier side of like what they've been doing.
I love the riff. It's great. The Blackmore solos on this song are great, and they don't sound as trademark Blackmore as I'd expect. It's really cool because they're doing that riff together and it's hard pan to both sides.
Yeah.
Between the guitar and the organ, and then when they separate it out like that, it's really cool. That part reminds me almost of like more of a Steve Morse era style. Steve Morse, Don Airey sort of thing. It's It's a long opening track, though. It's almost 7 minutes.
Doesn't feel like it.
No. Some like good little instrumental interludes, some great guitar solos. To have such an epic sounding song to open an album. Sounds more like almost like it could be a closer. Statement. All right, the battle rages on. John, what do you think of that track?
Wow, so that's been a good while since I've heard that. Let's see, where am I in the
fumbled with the spreadsheet too.
Ew. Okay, there we go. There's the spreadsheet. There's the old spreadsheet.
Spreadsheet of Rooney.
So that's been quite a while since I've heard that. So I feel like some of my memories of that have been shattered because, you know, I always thought like the production on this was not that great. I kind of, you know, have found that that's wrong. It's a little grittier. It's a little heavier. Like it's still Deep Purple, but it's like, it's more raw. It's kind of like, not really a return because like their earlier sound was raw in a different way. This is raw, like heavier. Mm-hmm. Cause the 80s stuff was definitely heavy, but it had a little bit of that sheen on it. And, you know, Slaves and Masters definitely polished, you know, very studio sound. This sounded very live. You could really hear all the instruments. Like I always thought that like Pace's drums were, I don't know, had like everything just had too much echo on it. That was my memory, but actually everything was really well defined in the mix, or as well as it could be here. Like, I mean, I heard, you know, Roger's bass, you know, I heard, you know, Lord was really prominent in there. Richie wasn't too loud. Like he was like, everybody seemed to be at the right level. And Richie, you could tell was Richie in a solo, but it was like, again, it was more raw, like the way it was produced. And I like Gillan doing, you know, he had the layered vocals at this point. One thing that I didn't like though is like the kill 'em all lyrics. Yeah. When he said that, like whenever I heard that, I was always like, I think he ripped that off from Metallica's first album. Like that's all I could ever think of.
You're just thinking he's lifting everything from anybody.
Well, really, I mean, he's just like, kill 'em all, you know. It's just like, okay, like it sounded, maybe it's just because it was too familiar of a phrase or something like that. I felt like it was like, you know, some things stick out and then you're just like, I don't like the way it sounds. But overall, I thought it was you know, a good sounding well-written song, kind of like the new intention for the heavier Purple, you know. I mean, I think as heavy as they could possibly get at that point. So I give it a 3.5. You know, definitely a strong opening track with some, you know, little issues in there, but, you know, overall thought it was pretty good. And I like that, you know, an epic opener, you know, it was just kind of like Purple's back, Mark II's back.
Yeah. Yeah. Very, very strong opener. Yeah. I was kind of on the fence about this one, but I will give it I'll give it a 3.5 as well. I love the, I mean, it's just a really, really great,
heavy riff.
Well composed riff, heavy. I love the interplay between the guitar and the organ. Gillan says it's archetypal Purple, but very 90s with it, very expressive. It flows very naturally and is one of the few tunes where you feel that John Lord was involved in the writing. Roger's lyrical idea was that when the Berlin Wall came down, everyone felt it, and it was the end of trouble. But at the last count, there were 26 wars going on around the world. So kind of that's where the idea of the battle rages on going. And he talks later about Yugoslavia being part of that. But, you know, it is a good idea. I remember, you know, watching it live on TV with all those guys like sitting on top of the wall. And it's like, oh, my God, the wall's coming down. This is like, I can't believe it. It's like like world peace is here. And it's like, not at all. I mean, it's better than it was during World War II, but it's definitely far from world peace. So anyway, yeah, that's 3.5 from me. I think I really dig it. It's and interesting you talk about the production, because that is definitely the common claim about this album is like, oh, we like this album, but it's got terrible production. I feel like it's almost one of those things that gets parroted, maybe somewhat unfairly. I'm sure that, you know, there's some justified use of that, but
well, I mean, I think that, you know, maybe that was my my aversion to listening to this album is that like it sounded different to me at the time from other Purple productions, and then hearing that like afterwards, like, oh, the production wasn't that great. I kind of like I don't know, what's that word when you remember something, you know, that it wasn't really there, you just remember because people said it,
like the Mandela effect or whatever.
Yeah, something like that. It's, oh yeah, the production was horrible, you know, without even listening to it. And just like, yeah, that's probably why I don't like it, you know, without actually even listening to it again. But
yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Which I mean, if you look at it, you know, it's probably like, well, I prefer the production of, say, this album, but doesn't mean that the production of this album was terrible.
Right. Yeah, I mean, I think it's a common thing that just happens again and again, which is that people hear things parroted and then they just parrot it back and don't. And one of the great things about doing a show like this or just even if just listening to it in your own way is really just working really hard to form your own opinions about what it is without necessarily paying attention to what's been said over the years, because it's really easy to just fall into that trap. Too easy sometimes. So
and I've been open about saying that I've been guilty of that, like, so much, you know. But I mean, I'll admit it, you know. I won't be one of those people that sits here and is just like, yeah, it stinks, without like listening to it again. Like I said, I probably haven't heard this album like front to back like since it came out, so you know, my adult ears will give it another chance.
All right, on to the next track, and that track is track 2, Lick It Up. A little bit of a different sound for them. Oh, of course.
Wow, Gillan's really changed his voice.
Yeah, he's really changed his whole approach. Sorry. I know it was a cheap joke. Sorry, had to throw that in there, but obviously
for a split second I'm just like, I think that the wrong one came up. Nate didn't
if I had like searched Spotify, oh, this must be it's the first one that comes up, this must be it.
Well, that was my first thought, was that the Deep Purple was covering Lick It Up, which I thought was really bizarre before I heard it.
That would be amazing if it was a Lick It Up cover. But yeah, so this it's suspected that this track is what blossomed from the demo called Little Miss Promiscuous.
Oh, geez.
So it changed into Lick It Up. And just a few little, since you brought up the Kiss thing, in Rock World magazine, and I want to give a huge appreciation to so many of our listeners who I solicited for articles. Jeff Bryce sent some stuff over. Who else? That's Will Porter sent out just amazing PDFs of all scans of magazines, and I'll give everyone credit in the next episode, because we're not going to get into too much of them now. Everyone sent tons of reviews and really appreciate it, because it was a really great source of information. But Ian Gillan in Rock World magazine says, "We hadn't been together for a long time when we made that one. On the new album, I think The Battle Rages On and Lick It Up are really 1990s rock and get it right in the groove. Apparently there's a Kiss song called Lick It Up, but ours is nothing like it."
Apparently
from like what, 10 years earlier or almost. And in Raw magazine, Gillan says, I had no idea Kiss had a track of the same name, although I hear it's nothing like it. It just felt dirty to me. And that's my favorite track on the album. So here we go. Lick It Up, the Deep Purple cover, Ian Gillan's favorite track on the album. This one's written by Blackmore, Gillan, and Glover.
It's kind of a, yeah, really groove-oriented, like, dirty-sounding riff. Like a Blackmore's rhythm sound that he's getting on this album so far.
Yeah, it's different.
Gillan's got a really, like, you know, just dry vocal effect going on.
I mean, they definitely focus on Lick It Up a lot less in the chorus than Kiss.
Yeah.
Lick It Up, and then it's over right back into the verse.
Yeah, I think that helps, you know?
Yeah, if they were like, Lick It Up, Lick It Up.
The way that Gillan's singing the verses is very like Ian Gillan's solo band kind of way of singing for him.
Yeah, coming hot off the heels of Dark Rocket. Great little guitar solo interlude, but just too low. Couldn't make it out.
Yeah. Nice.
Such a great Blackmore little riffy after the Lick It Up that he throws in there. Almost sounds like he has like an octave on or something. Very unusual tone for him.
I don't really hear John Lord in this song a lot at all.
No.
I mean, if he even is there, he's buried in the mix. Like, it's makes it for a very unusual Purple tune, because you don't, like, it's very like groove oriented, you know, the guitar riff, but there's no, you know, there's no space in there for the keyboard or like I mean, I didn't hear anything.
No, it's very, very buried. All right, so of this, yeah, so I already told you, yeah, I already read the quotes about this. So what do you think about Lick It Up?
Well, not as classic as the Kiss Lick It Up. That's okay.
No, and I think that's, you know, it's a hard one to beat. I Lick It Up, I've heard it on the radio a million times.
I mean, I feel because Ian Gillan said it, like, I would believe that he's like, oh, Kiss has a song called Lick It Up. He's the only person I would believe, like, would be so many oblivious that he wouldn't even know.
So many, like, people are just so full of crap.
Anybody else, right? I would be like, you know, like if Joe Lynn Turner said, I'd be like, oh, you're full of shit. You know, there's a Kiss song called Lick It Up. But for some reason, I could believe that Gillan is like so in his own world. He's like, oh, I didn't know Kiss wrote a song called that.
Yeah, I don't think he has much reason to make that up. But
that'd be funny if they had a song on this called Rock and Roll All Night. No, Kiss wrote a song called Rock and Roll All Night. Like, that's like way more specific.
It's so strange.
Oh, yeah, geez. I hear that it's different from ours. That being said, I think it's another, like, I am really getting into the sound of this album. Like, I feel like the aforementioned, like, quote unquote, bad production is really just a really live sound.
Yeah.
I've identified right now, which I really like. And I like that Blackmore's tones are much different on this album. Like, they're really grittier and heavier. And it's like, it's kind of different for them. But I mean, you know, in their wheelhouse, because you know that they can, you know, they can do that kind of stuff. But anyways, I liked it. The only thing I didn't like was Blackmore's solos, which, as you pointed out, were really low in the mix. Like, if they were going to do some kind of rhythm, you know, bridge type of thing, and you know, kind of melodic thing, but it's like, that would have worked. But I mean, there was obviously like a guitar solo in there that was really hard to hear. So you know, based on the groove and everything, which I really liked through the song, I'll give it a 3.5. I liked it.
I will give it a 3.5 as well. I love the groove of it. I agree with what you're saying about missing John Lord a bit in this.
That's the other thing, yeah.
But yeah, and the solos were great. They reminded me of kind of that like later era Mark III sort of stuff, where he was getting just like a little more like, I don't even know what the right word for it is, but he was just being a little bit more like sly about his solos. And it sounds like he's doing that again here, for lack of a better term, but it's very low in the mix. And it's a little, I mean, just a little bit of EQ and a little volume bump on those, I think, would have served it well. I love what he's playing. I wish I just could hear it a little bit better. So
yeah, like, I mean, if you had something really upfront and defined, and like, you know, you just had this really, I don't know, just kind of like nasty, like, you know, overdriven guitar tone or something, like a really ripping Ritchie solo in there over that kind of like melodic, like, you know, riff, or like you know, whatever he was doing, like in the solo section, I think that would have gone great. But you know,
yeah, but I love the rhythm, when he's throwing that in every time he says lick it up. It's just,
yeah,
that classic. I think Richie's really expert at making those riffs that aren't just like a 4-bar riff. He'll turn a 4-bar riff into an 8-bar riff, and then he'll put these little variations every fourth bar or whatever that can extend it into being an 8-bar riff. You know, it's mm-hmm. those little flourishes that make it really cool. It's not just a paranoid down. He's throwing in tons of little flourishes that make it really interesting. Okay, well, the next track up is the third track. I was gonna say on the first side, but on the CD, and this one is called Anya. It's warming up for Blackmore's Night here. And this one is Blackmore, Gillan, Glover, and Lord again. Great acoustic sound, though. I mean, I just love the sound of the fingers on the strings. Like a little harpsichord in the background sound.
Nice. Very, like, you know, triumphant, majestic, classic Purple sounding.
This sounds like the knight coming to slay those two fighting dragons. Knock it off, you two! Cut it out! Yeah.
feel like this could have been on Perfect Strangers. It's got a real Perfect Strangers kind of vibe to it.
Totally.
Classic John Lord in there. Sound.
Listen to the lyrics here. This is an interesting word that pops up. Across the pusta, plain to see. We'll talk about the pusta later. That melody that you said is like triumphant. It's got like a that triumphant spirit, that exploration. That comes a great Blackmore solo.
There we go.
Again, I think it's a little lost in the mix.
I think it was definitely more upfront, kind of what I wanted from Lick It Up.
More than Lick It Up.
What I had in mind.
Not front and center enough. What if what Gillan says about this album is to believe? I don't think Blackmore ever heard it. Or was present during the mixing or anything. I think he was done. I was done before he started, so... In the control room, I could see him saying, "Hey, faders up, man. This is a guitar solo."
I could picture that, though. He's just, "Am I done with my tracks? All right, see you later. I'm going to Palm Springs." I don't know.
And if there's a slide to be played, I'll get the screwdriver.
Here, you suckers mix it.
Nice. Hammer heavy, I don't know what you would call it, if it's like a harpsichordish sort of ending, which is really cool. And they actually, interestingly, I think, I'm pretty sure I saw that they played this with Simon McBride live pretty recently. Just really cool.
I think so. I think I had heard something about that.
That they would bring this one back. But
yeah, well, I mean, it's very classic sounding.
What do you think of it? What do you think of it?
Yeah, I look at him like, well, are you gonna ask? Or like,
I did ask, but you didn't hear me.
I missed it. Sorry. Okay. this, I guess you could say this song is problematic for me because I like it, but there's something missing. I don't know what it is. I don't know if it's like the energy and the performance, if it's John Lord's keyboards. I don't know. I think it might be like the energy of it. I feel like if like this is a song that would be like really great live, but I feel like it lacks a certain kind of energy in the studio recording. You know, it's just like I feel like the you know what I mean? I just feel it's like there were points like where they came out of the solo and I was like, it's just kind of like, you know, whatever. And it, you know, it didn't feel like a fist raising or fist pumping type of like vibe to it. It felt very like subdued. And even like Gillan singing, it just, it was like, you know, it's like, where's like the drive, you know? Maybe they were just kind of phoning it in during this one, you know, because I feel like the song is good and the riff is good. And I disagree on the solo. I think the solo had the energy that I was looking for. Like, you know, he had like classic Ritchie, you know, I thought it was up enough in the mix, but that was probably one of my favorite parts, but it was like peaks and valleys. Mm-hmm. You know, as I thought the energy was like, you know, up and then it was down a little bit, you know, it was kind of inconsistent. I would say if it were a live version, I'd probably give it higher, but I'll give this one a 3.5. Just cause I feel like, you know, if I heard it live, I think I'd hear more of what I want to hear from this song.
Yep. I think I'll give it a 3.5 for the same reasons. Yeah, and when you mentioned that, it kind of goes back to the dun 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 dun. Like, what I thought of was, like it should hit like a, you know, da da dun da da dun da da dun da da dun da.
Right.
Like that really comes in with that punch. And this one, and maybe it's just because it's, I mean, it's keyboard heavy. Is Ritchie playing in that part? Dun, 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 dun. I don't know if he's throwing a guitar, but it doesn't. Yeah, it sounds more distant, like it's being mic'd. Where the microphone's not, you know, it's not like the microphone's not here. The microphone's here, you know?
Yeah.
And you want to have that up in your face during that part. Like it should punch a little bit more. I mean, that's just a production note, but.
Yeah, there wasn't any intensity in some of those parts that I think the song really needed.
Yeah. So Glover says that they'd written this song, but they didn't have an intro. John Lord played an intro and for it, and then Ritchie said, and he said, nah, shit. So I guess he didn't like John Lord's intro. It's great that you could just be like, ah, John Lord just did something. No, that's shit. Like, how ballsy do you have to be to say that? So Ritchie grabbed an acoustic guitar, and Glover said he just noodled around for like 40 minutes. And then John came in the next day and asked what Ritchie thought of his intro, and Roger culled through all of Ritchie's acoustic playing and then stitched it together. What he thought would be a good intro, and then John Lord played around with it to fit in with what Ritchie was doing. So that's what you're hearing. Glover says it cost me a complete day of work. I was cutting and pasting instead of live, but I think it turned out very well. And then Ian Gillan in Raw magazine, where they repeatedly call the song Auya, A-U-Y-A, instead of A-N. Like it's not just once, it's like multiple times. So maybe it's just because it hadn't come out yet and they weren't sure. But he says it's similar in structure to Woman from Tokyo, where you take the spirit of the people and country and turn it into a girl. It's about the spirit and freedom that existed behind the Iron Curtain before it came down, the overwhelming desire in every culture to have freedom of expression. It's the spirit of Hungary, actually the people who were almost destroyed by the regime, but who always fought back. So here we are. Yeah, so this is like almost a concept album at this point. It's constantly referring back to these Iron Curtain thing. And where he says the pusta, that is like the plains or the grasslands in Hungary. Mm-hmm. So I know he did like a wedding in Hungary and all this sort of stuff. So he must be connected with the land and the stuff there, because it's not a song you hear just bandied about in common pop songs. Pusta. All right, that's pusta for you. All right, on to the next track. The
all right
track.
What? All right, you're like all right
pusta putza. I have a hard time saying it. Putza. Here we go. This next track is called Talk About Love, and this is written by Blackmore, Gillan, and Glover.
Nice. I feel like we got a lot of like groove oriented stuff going on here, like really heavy groove oriented.
Yeah, this one's more akin to Lick It Up.
Getting down to Rosie's in this one. I wonder if he's busting out for Rosie.
Yeah, good stuff.
I like that. A lot of double entendre there.
Gillan? No.
Usually single entendre with him. But
single entendre.
It's interesting that the last line of the last verse is "I want to talk about love," and then he picks up the next verse with "You talk about the weather."
I mean, definitely like a head bobber, you know, toe tapper.
Yeah.
You know, you can, Ruben. Yeah. I was just thinking, like, where's John Lord again?
Yeah, I feel like he's coming through in the right channel, at least on my headphones, like during that solo in particular. But I think it's the tones he's using on his organ, too, that blend in a little bit more. It doesn't cut through quite as much. And we haven't heard any, like, classic Hammond yet. At least it doesn't sound like it. Maybe it's there low, but I haven't picked up on any Hammond yet. And it's always kind of, there's usually a point on any Deep Purple album where you bust out a classic Hammond solo and you're like, oh, thank God.
Yeah.
kind of a cool little, boom, 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 boom. I don't know if he was doing that using volume swells on his guitar, but it's a cool effect. But of that track, Ian Gillan says in Raw, very briefly, kind of funky, tongue in cheek. I like the words. It's great. Like, hey, what do you think of that song? I like the words.
I like my lyrics.
Richie, what do you think of that song? Ah, great guitar in it. I like it. I like my guitar.
Well, I mean, yeah. So this song reminded me, I know it might sound like a weird comparison, maybe not, but stick with me on this. So there are, you know, there were some like, you know, 80s bands that kind of were in this era, like early 90s, who were kind of doing those like back to basics, stripped down type of like groove oriented albums. Like it kind of reminded me of like something off of like Dr. Feelgood, Motley Crue. Oh, yeah. Like I don't know, Slice of Your Pie or Rattlesnake Shake or something like that. Like those kind of like really big sounding, like groove oriented, like stripped down kind of rockers type of thing. Yeah. Like what like the 80s bands were trying to do like around the early 90s time, which isn't definitely not you know, a bad thing. Mm-hmm. It's just it kind of had that same thing, because I think everybody was trying to do that stripped down kind of like, you know, dirty groove type of thing, which I think was actually really well done. It was kind of a nice change of pace, like in the early 90s, for a lot of these bands to like, you know, have all that, because you're basically getting this like kind of groove oriented, like, you know, rock with like this really big sounds, you know, and they were kind of going away from all of the, you know, crazy guitar pyrotechnics or like, you know, 80s sounding production and trying to get back to basics type of thing. But this is what it kind of reminded me of. That part I really liked. You know, that being said, like it's almost like I wasn't as like didn't catch me as much as like I don't know, like say like Lick It Up. So you know, I'll give it a 3. Almost approaching filler territory, but not quite. Maybe as close as you'll get on this album so far.
All right. I'll give it a 3.5. I think it kind of fits along with the other tracks really well. And again, that groove oriented sort of thing. And and I guess trying to keep in mind the story behind this album too. And I think a lot of people, it's one of those ones that's somewhat divisive from what I'm gathering from just, you know, if it comes up in social media and people are talking about it, there's people that love it, there's people that hate it. And there's a lot of people, and there's not a ton of people in between. There's people that are just, it's okay. But I feel like there's people that really love it despite what was going on in the band at the time. I think the people that don't like it are probably picking up on the fact that it's a little stitched together, because Gillan wasn't really there during the music writing process the way he would have been normally, and some of the vocals are stuck on. Now, could you tell that if you didn't know the story behind that? I mean, I doubt it. I'm sure you wouldn't, but knowing that backstory, you can kind of hear how some of it maybe doesn't fit the way. And you know, when you're imagining in your head what would JLT be doing during this, you can hear mm-hmm. something very different, obviously, because they're a very different style. I mean, so far, this my impressions, my memory of this album was always just kind of, it's good, you know, like it's a good album, but it never really jumped out at me. But I know there's some people like Jerry Bloom. This is his favorite of all the reunion albums, include, you know, from Perfect Strangers on. So I mean, that's pretty high praise from someone who's as knowledgeable about Deep Purple as he is. So for some people it really resonates, and I think some of that might have had to be where you were when this came out. And I think we were caught up in the earlier stuff because we were just getting into it, and the folks that had been around that for a while maybe paid a little more mind to this.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so there is only one more track that we're going to be getting into until next episode. And that is the fifth track on the album, Time to Kill. So classic paice snare foot.
Almost sounds like a rainbow riff.
That reminds me of Satriani. That waves in a very odd turn when the lyrics come out. Another kind of in the triumphant vibe.
Very upbeat.
Yeah. Much more, yeah, like happy sounding than a Deep Purple chorus generally is. Word for that, like Blackmore intro to a solo, it's like sounds like orchestrated falling down the stairs, like it's classic thing, and I don't mean that at all in a negative way, of course.
No, it's true. Yeah,
it's like his classic little go-to. It's so awesome. It's his version of Tommy Bolin.
It's not as easy though to emulate.
No, it's a lot. Yeah, I think I could do the Tommy Bolin one a little better than the Ritchie. You hear the organ cutting through a little more now.
Yeah. Yeah, I was just gonna say that. I don't know it was that way the whole time, but it's like he's definitely there now.
It sounds like they just like, oh shit, halfway through the song, they forgot they turned the volume up. Oops. But it sounds more like that almost Hammondy.
Yeah, classic Lord sound. Lord.
Again, though, it's low.
I know. I'm taking what I can get, though.
Yeah. You know, the funny thing is, it's like, it doesn't sound like his classic Hammond, but I like know that it is, you know what I mean? Like, yeah. It's just the way it's produced doesn't quite have that same growl to it that you would expect.
Yeah.
And now, you know, I'm really starting to, again, it's interesting, no matter how many times you hear these albums, even though this was never like, you know, when I listened to hundreds and hundreds of times, but when we do it in this format, I always pick up on things that I never heard before, even if it's something I heard a million times. And for me, that I'm really starting to understand what people are talking about when they talk about the production on this album.
Yeah.
And to me, as we've discussed many times, production is not my number one. Like, if the songs are, if it's good songwriting, I don't really care. But the basic stuff of guitar taking the center stage or organ taking the center stage when it's on a solo, that sort of stuff's hard to get past on something that's as big and as important as this album was.
Yeah.
But yeah, it was great to finally hear Lord come through on the end there. But what do you think of Time to Kill?
I think I feel like the more that I listened to it, I was like, the song isn't fully realized. Like, I don't know. I feel like there's stuff in there that I would have liked to have heard, you know, like coming out of the solo, like if you did that kind of like, you know, that Poison, Nothing But a Good Time, you know, you know, like that kind of like, you know, triumphant thing, you know, where it's like, you know, you hit the, you know, you choke the cymbal and everything, you know, it's like, you know, just like dynamics in the song, you know what I mean? I mean, even in the verse, like Ritchie did that, you know, his octave thing is like, it's like, all right, Ritchie, we know. and, you know, Lord's solo at the end was like kind of soft, but I mean, like the outro kind of made me think like, yeah, that's kind of the energy that I wanted through the song. Like, it sounded like it would be like, it would have made a really good kind of like poppy, you know, even, you know, anthem type song, or really like, you know, it could have been more upbeat, you know. It's just like, I feel like maybe the song wasn't finished, or a finished idea, but I liked it for what it could be. That being said, I'll give it a 2.5. Like, I'm kind of like, I like it, but I'm disappointed because I wanted more. And now I'm going to eat I've been munching on these eggs. We're gonna have another one.
You're gonna have to make we're gonna have to cancel next week's episode because he's gonna be taking a trip up to Montreal to buy some more.
I don't know, for next episode.
Too bad. You should have told me about that, man. I could have reached out to my family up there and said, hey, can my buddy John and his friends stay with you?
I know,
or
right?
Maybe I should have reached out for that French family. Hey, long story, this family from France I've never met, could they come stay with you? They're cool. They would have been like, sure. I'm gonna have to agree with you on a 2.5. I kind of have to do it. I felt like it was it was a little low energy, like a time for giving, a time for taking. You know, it was just like, it was it felt like it had all the elements there, like that. So I really wished both solos were more in your face. The production on the Hammond really bummed me out, because I just wanted that to roar like it has on so many other albums and so many other performances over the years. And it was just kind of in the background. And like I said, I know that's John Lord playing his Hammond, but it doesn't sound like it. It sounded like he was almost using like an organ patch on a synthesizer, which, God, nobody wants to lug around that huge Hammond with those Leslie speakers and everything. If it's going to sound like a synthesizer patch, I mean, that's the whole point of it. And I very much doubt that's what it was. It had to have been him playing the organ. And I guess that's my main, it ties into my main complaint or I don't know if complaint's the right word, but with the whole, everything since the reunion has been so light on the John Lord. And that's what really, the interplay between him and Blackmore is what made Mark II work so well, and Mark III for that matter. And it just seems like he was pushed to the background. You know, he's a few good moments. He does amazing stuff, amazing backup stuff, but
yeah,
man, if John Lord's in your band, I want to hear those trade-offs. You know, there's some songs where there's three guitar solos, like throw John Lauderbone in there. That's what people, that's what makes people love this band, is hearing that. But, but anyway, yeah, it's like you said, I think there were a lot of good bones there to it, but it seems a little, and again, I think this is the first song that really sounded like it was stitched together. Like, what you would expect from a song that was written and recorded with another singer and then had those tracks erased and had another singer write new words to, you know, he made it fit in. And that kind of happy go lucky chorus was a little unusual. They took a cool risk there, but it didn't quite pay off for me.
Yeah.
So there you have it, folks. We're halfway through the album. You know, still see, this is why we're even like I said, if you take out the Airbnb story and the other thing, you still got a pretty long episode on your hands. Next week, we won't have as much to catch up on because we'll be all caught up.
We're back on the grind.
Other than occasional, yeah, texts, we've been out of contact. But hey, before we wrap it up, there is one last thing we have to do, and that is, of course, to thank our foundation level patrons. Searching for them here on the spreadsheet. Ah, here we go. the show notes on this one are a little crazy. Okay, so coming in at the $3.33 halfway to Evil tier, we have none other than Raf Calf. At the $3 Nobody's Perfect tier, we have Peter Gardeau, Ian DeRosier, Mark Roback, Duncan Leesk, Stuart McCord, Flight of the Rap Bat Blue Light, Ivan Fieldboo. It's a great life if you don't. Runar Siemensen. It's a great life if you don't weekend. And JJ Stenard. Coming in at the $1 made up name tier, we have the Undead Bootlegger, Leaky Mausoleum. I think I forgot to change that from last week. Let's see, the Raging Battle of Liquids. I don't know. Leaky Mausoleum. Stephen Somerville, the Concerto 1999 Fanatic. Spike the Rock Cat. Hank the Tank. Private Eyes. Ashen Lionel. Spike's Mom. Blackmore's Tights. And John Maselli.
And they pay you too?
All right. Thank you so much to all of our amazing patrons for their continued support of the show. And yeah, I guess with that, we'll be back at you next week. We'll bust right into the music, tackle the final five songs on this album, and then get into some reviews, some how it did in the charts, kind of a little brief story of what happened afterwards, and merchandising, all sorts of stuff we'll get into next week. So
Deep Purple, the flamethrower.
Exactly. Oh boy,
the kids love this one.
All right, John, well, until next week, I'll talk to you later.
Okay,
bye-bye.
Thank you for listening to the Deep Purple podcast. If you like what you hear and would like more episodes in the future, please donate on Patreon to support the show. You can also leave us a review in Apple Podcasts to help new people discover the show. You can follow us on YouTube, Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook for show updates. See deeppurplepodcast.com for more details. Thank you for listening.